Hypothetical propositions play a surprisingly important role in both our language and our logic. It's important, then, that we understand how they work. Now remember that the general form of a hypothetical proposition is if-then. Here's a basic example. If the sun explodes tomorrow, then the human race won't survive. Remember that every hypothetical proposition is comprised of two parts. The antecedent is whatever immediately follows the word if, while the consequent is whatever follows the word then, whether the then is explicitly written or is implicit. Now let's think about what a hypothetical proposition is telling us. Hypothetical statements assert that if the antecedent is true, then the consequent is also true. This in turn entails that the only thing that will make a hypothetical statement false is if the antecedent is true and the consequent false. Any other combination of truth or falsity with the antecedent and consequent will make the hypothetical proposition true. In assessing the validity of arguments that employ hypothetical propositions, we want to first write the arguments in standard form, so we need to know how to label them. Here's our proposition again that we started with. Notice that we have put parentheses around both the antecedent and the consequent and labeled them P and Q. Based on that labeling, we can then label the rest of the argument in which this proposition might appear. Here would be an example. Premise 1, if the sun explodes tomorrow, the human race won't survive. Premise 2, the sun will explode tomorrow. Conclusion, the human race won't survive. Notice that the sun explodes tomorrow, which appears as the antecedent of the first premise, and appears as the second premise, is labeled P. While the human race won't survive, which is the consequent of the first premise and the conclusion, is labeled Q. If we write this argument out symbolically and compare it to our chart, we find that the argument is a valid modus ponens. Now, one mistake that students often make is to want to label propositions based on whether they sound negative or not. Let's look at another example to illustrate what I mean by this. In the first premise, we have the same proposition we've been working with. If the sun explodes tomorrow, then the human race won't survive. Premise 2 says the human race will survive. Now notice that the human race won't survive is labeled Q here, while premise 2 is labeled not Q. Intuitively, that might seem backwards. But remember that with mixed hypothetical arguments, the hypothetical proposition will always be labeled P and Q. So the rest of the argument is labeled according to that. The human race will survive is the negation of Q, and the sun won't explode tomorrow is the negation of P. So, writing out the argument symbolically, we have if P then Q, therefore not P, which is a valid modus tollens. Finally, we have to say a few words about how to write out pure hypothetical syllogisms in standard form. Let's look at this example. If someone lights a match near a gas pump, they have created a hazardous situation. Because if someone creates a threat of explosion, they have created a hazardous situation. And if someone lights a match near a gas pump, they have created a threat of explosion. The first thing we want to do is to write out the premises and the conclusion as follows. Now, a tendency here is to start by labeling premise 1 P and Q. Look what happens if we do that. The second premise gets labeled if R then P, and the conclusion gets labeled if R then Q. If we write that out symbolically, we have if P then Q, if R then P, therefore if R then Q. This does not obviously match any of the argument forms that appear in the table in section 7.1, so it's hard to assess the validity of this argument. Look, however, what happens if instead we begin by labeling the conclusion if P then R. Now we can go back, put parentheses around the antecedents and consequents of both of the premises, and label them accordingly. Now we have if Q then R, second premise if P then Q, conclusion if P then R. Now again, this doesn't look quite right. The reason is that premise 1 should always contain that part of the proposition that's labeled P. So in other words, we now have to switch the order of both of the premises. If we do so, we get premise 1 if P then Q, premise 2 if Q then R, conclusion if P then R. Or again, writing this out symbolically, we find that this is a valid pure hypothetical syllogism. Now that was a lot of work getting to that final form. There's an important hint that you should follow then when dealing with pure hypotheticals. The hint is, when writing a pure hypothetical syllogism in standard form, don't write down its premises until after you've written down and labeled its conclusion. In other words, write down its conclusion first. Always label it if P then R. Then find the premise that contains the P, write it, label it, and then write the other premise. If you do so, you'll find that you'll always have one of the four forms that are listed in the table in the chapter. You now have all the tools that are necessary to assess the validity of hypothetical syllogisms. In the following sections, we're going to add some complexity to this topic.